Now, our next speaker, Deborah Ann Sievis, is with Stanford University Law School. She is the Luke W. Cole Professor of Environmental Law. Deborah.
Thank you, David. We've heard a lot this morning on marine spatial planning, so I thought I would step back from that a little bit, and I'll try to elaborate some on some of the local land use impacts that are affecting our marine environment and that will play a role in how we think about marine spatial planning in terms of the ocean and the ocean resources. We also have to be thinking about what we're doing on land and how we can limit some of the impacts there. I'm going to, of necessity, kind of give a broad brush approach, but I'll try to focus on a few things, a few uses along the coast that I think California has real problems with, but in many cases has tried to step out in front of what the federal government is doing. And again, you heard a little bit about that this morning. And my goal here is really to almost tell stories about some of the policies that have been developed and some of the tools that people are thinking about from a legal perspective and a policy perspective, you know, kind of as a way to have all of you out there thinking about your own local communities and how you can play a role in helping further advocacy for our coastal resources. We have a huge number of people who live along the coast, which is a good thing because we all enjoy the coast. I'm actually a native Southern Californian too, although living in the Bay Area now. But it's a good and a bad thing. So there are many millions of people who live and work in coastal communities, if you broadly define that term, and there are many millions more who come and visit our communities every day. So important to, I think, all of our emotional and physical well-being as well. Okay, so what are some of the threats that we're facing? Again, as I said, I'll talk in kind of broad strokes, but the way I think of them as you could put them into sort of three broad categories. So industrial activities, of which we have many along the coast, and I'll talk about a few and a few of the policies that we've tried to put in place to begin to deal with them. Uncontrolled pollution runoff from a variety of sources, from all of us and our stormwater runoff of all the places that we live, but also agricultural pollution is a huge issue in California. Runoff from other activities like logging in some of our coastal forests. And finally, I'll try to, if I have time, try to say a word just about habitat destruction and what on the coast as opposed to in the water, which we'll leave that to maybe some other speakers, just to give a little flavor of what some people are thinking on that front in terms of trying to push our policies forward. Talk a little bit about how we got where we are on coastal power plants. Desalinization facilities, which are going to become a huge issue, I think, on the California coast, as they are throughout the world. And finally, vessel discharges. You heard Meg say that we don't know that much about invasive species out there, but we do know that they're coming in pretty regularly on through ships, as well as other pollutants, but invasives are really the big one there with ships. Okay, so coastal power plants. We had 21 coastal power plants along the coasts of California, from Humboldt all the way down to way down below here to the almost to the Mexican border. I think there are 19 that are still functioning today. Those power plants need to be cooled in some way, and so Brian talked this morning about once through cooling, and that in fact was how all of those power plants were built, most of them built in the 50s and 60s. And in fact, one of the reasons that they were located along the coast is there was nice cold Pacific water to cool them down. I think what we probably didn't realize when we built them is that the 17 billion gallons a day that they collectively take in is teeming with marine life. So anything from, you know, otters, occasionally an otter has even gotten sucked into a power plant, but and turtles and fish, but all the way down to the very base of our food web in the ocean, the larvae that are very abundant in our coastal waters, and all of that is pulled into these power plants along the coast and basically destroyed because of the processes that go on. So a few years ago, people started getting concerned about this, and at the federal, it started probably first at the federal level, where the Environmental Protection Agency under the Clean Water Act actually has an obligation to regulate these facilities, but had not issued any general regulations and had not really been doing a very proactive job at dealing with them. And some environmental groups came forward and sued the agency for its failure to regulate these sources, and there was the agency agreed to go forward and issue some new regulations, which it did, and then of course they were promptly challenged by, I think, both sides, by both the conservation community and by the industry, and it resulted in a couple of very high-profile decisions, the Riverkeeper case, and in the Second Circuit Court of Appeal, and went all the way up to the federal Supreme Court. Those regulations were largely upheld, but pieces of them were overturned and sent back to the agency. So waiting for almost 40 years for these regulations, they are still not in place. They are still back the ball's back at EPA's door to try to figure that out, and we still haven't heard much. So in the meantime, the state of California jumped into the fray, and the State Water Resources Control Board, which has the primary responsibility for overseeing water quality in California, began a series of hearings and public meetings that took about 5 years. I think in 2005 they were started, and just towards the end of 2010, finally came to a decision on a new policy. And the electricity grid in California, the Energy Commission, Coastal Commission, State Lands Commission, lots of people, Ocean Protection Council, lots of people weighed in. But at the end of the day, a policy came out of the State Water Board that has not outlawed once-through cooling, but has put some pretty robust standards in place and trying to really get this technology phased out. There is other technology there. Sometimes there's a feasibility issue in terms of size. Mostly it's a matter of economics. The final policy was adopted in October of 2010. It's under judicial challenge right now, but I'm confident it's going to move forward and be in place. So we're going to probably start to see the phase out of that activity, which will diminish the impacts that we're having on those resources. But just at about the same time, we've got the issue of desal happening here in California, as it is across the world. And obviously, we're a water-hungry state, and water-thirsty state, I guess. And so there are many, many desal plants that are being proposed along the California coast, and they raise real issues. So one of them is, are they growth-inducing along the coast? Is that the place where we should we be packing more people into the coastal communities, given the impacts that we're already having on the ocean environment? But it certainly raises that issue, and is one that policy makers are discussing. There's issues around privatization of water, and what does that mean? But mostly what I wanted to focus on is the ecological impacts. So these are facilities that are often being placed where these old power plants might actually be phasing out their once through cooling, and they're doing the exact same thing, which is pulling in marine water and destroying the marine life within that water. So they raise pretty serious issues, and we're going to see, I think, more about this. And I know there's some people in the audience working on this issue. The first real one just down the road here, the Poseidon Resources has proposed a facility in Carlsbad. And I think it's a lesson in maybe what we don't want to do in the future, which is a potential developer coming to the local agencies and asking for various permitting approvals to go forward with this desal plant. There's a fair amount of opposition in the community, and so we have this huge battle going on. Pretty much every California environmental statute has been invoked: the California Environmental Quality Act, the Port of Colon Act, the Coastal Act, the State Lands Commission has its own authority, and it doesn't seem like a very good way to do policy here in California. So I think one of the reasons why I wanted to raise the desal thing is I think it raises the very issue that our next panelists are going to talk about, which is to think about comprehensive planning on the ocean side. But desal is an ocean dependent activity. So I think that would be rolled into anything that we would do in terms of thinking about ocean planning too. Should we do it in advance? Think about the policy implications. Think about where's the right place, where's not the right place, and how we do it. If we do it, how we do it. There are other techniques than just there's beach wells and other techniques to actually try to mitigate some of the damages that's being done. Okay, so discharges. I'm trying to keep on track here. Discharges from vessels. Vessels are huge sources of pollution. All kinds of waste streams come off of them. I think EPA recently identified 26 different waste streams, but the really big one that has had people quite worried is invasive species coming out of ballast water tanks. So ballast water tanks are these huge tanks in the cargo holds of big tankers where water is taken on and let out in order to keep the trim of the boat at the right level depending on what cargo it's carrying. But they come from these ships come from all over the world, so they carry with them creatures from all over the world. So EPA has identified, in recent years, has identified invasive species as one of the leading threats to ecosystem health, both terrestrially, but certainly in the aquatic environment. This is kind of EPA's policy statement that invasive species can affect aquatic ecosystems at all levels and represent the second leading cause of species extinction and loss of biodiversity. So it's a pretty big issue. Until very recently, the EPA, despite this statement, had declined to regulate invasive species under the under the Clean Water Act, which they have authority to do, and in fact, an obligation to do. So again, citizens groups started out by petitioning the agency to actually step up to the plate and begin to regulate these impacts. And here's one of the reasons why people are so concerned. This is the zebra mussel, which probably most of you have heard of. It's mostly a Great Lakes phenomenon, but all of these Great Lakes species are making their way to the West Coast. Zebra is the one that's gotten a lot of press. More recently, the quagga mussel is also a huge problem, and we're now seeing it here in Southern California, in Arizona, moving up the West Coast. Kind of inevitable when you have these trans-ocean ships moving around the world. So this I included this picture just to show that from 1988 to 1993, that's 5 years, that was how that species moved in the Great Lakes region. So it's kind of scary. Up in the San Francisco Bay Area, and this is actually statistics from an older study, I suspect the numbers are even worse, over 234 invasive species have been identified in San Francisco Bay and Delta. And in some places, it's most of the biomass is now invasive species. So what is that doing to the health of our ecosystems? So what is the solution to this? Well, the Coast Guard got into the game before EPA did and began to require that that ships exchange their ballast water, dump their water offshore, so it's not coming into the coastal environment. If coastal species that are picked up in Asia or Europe come and are dumped in offshore, they're unlikely to survive. It's the problem when they're dumped into a local ecosystem that's more akin to the one that they're adapted to. There's more likelihood they're going to survive. So the Coast Guard began to do that several years ago, but studies have shown that in fact it's not all that effective. In some cases it can be effective, but there are safety reasons why sometimes it can't be done. They're hard to get out of the tank. So the EPA has come in now after some pressure and lawsuits and has issued a general permit that all ships have to come under the permit. And at this point, the permit's not very good. It's been challenged by conservation groups and the industry, but the EPA has convened some scientific panels and is really trying to put some more teeth into that permit. But in the meantime, California has stepped forward and come out with its own numerical standards, really trying to reduce the rate of invasion. So it's another example where sort of advocacy at the state level got California out ahead of the federal government. So I just have a, I'm going to run through some stuff here quickly. So turning away from industrial sources to the uncontrolled pollution runoff, this is, of course, a huge issue. For those of you who work on this, you know it's a frustrating issue. One big category of runoff is stormwater runoff, originally exempt from the Clean Water Act, but Congress realized that that was a problem, so a few decades ago put in place some stormwater requirements, but they aren't the same as the requirements that are imposed on industrial facilities because it's a diffuse source. It's hard to really get a handle on, but continues to be a big problem. Agricultural pollution, as Meg said, we're worried about nutrient loading, pesticide loading, sediment loading. Agriculture is completely exempt from the Clean Water Act, and so has been a continuing source. And logging, it has similar kinds of impacts. So just to run through this we'll run through this. So the stormwater management program that's in place is mostly run by local governments. So big sources may have to get their individual permit, but most of the smaller communities, they come under a general stormwater permit, and they're subject to certain best management practices to try to reduce stormwater runoff. Most of those practices are around education and outreach to the public about the things that you and I and all of us are doing, but hasn't been very effective. And I think one of the things that's happening in California, there's kind of this groundswell to start thinking, how do we get a handle on that? Is that through more litigation, more policy advocacy, or what? Agricultural pollution, completely unregulated. And so people are beginning to look at other theories for trying to regulate this this source, or trying to get a handle over this source. In California, this kind of pollution is subject to regulation, but has mostly been waived as allowed to do under state law. And those waivers simply kind of let business happen as usual. And so one of the things that a lot of people are talking about is, how do we push it? How do we get the regional boards and the state water board to really step up and put some more teeth into those waivers, some more requirements on the growers who are discharging pretty significant volumes of waste? And I'll slip through this one. Well, one other thing to say is that we're doing some of this work in the clinic. We're trying to kind of dust off some of the old theories of common law notion and trying to think how we can hold some of these agencies accountable to protect the public trust resources that are being affected by agriculture. And then logging, we got sort of the same problem, also mostly exempt from state and federal laws, but it can be a big problem. And I'll just end here on issues about habitat. We have loss of wetlands, an ongoing problem. People are trying to think of creative things to do there. Habitat restoration is one of them, but trying to stop the destruction is another. One of the things that we've talked about is trying to work with folks to get some of these coastal dams taken out. So those dams are are posing barriers to fish. And I'll leave you with this slide, which is some work that we're doing with folks in Marin County, the Lagunitas watershed, which is considered the best watershed for the Central Coast California coho. So these are the numbers. I don't have the last 2 years on here, but I can tell you that they're about where the 2008 numbers are, slightly a little bit better in 2010. These are the returning salmon to the Lagunitas watershed, the best watershed for the coho salmon. So it's kind of a scary picture there.